Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Impressionism and Post-Impressionism, these two movements are not necessarily a kind of organized art movement. They simply happened in response to certain situations that developed in the Western world, particularly in Europe, during the mid-19th century and late-19th century. Particularly after Romanticism and Realism are taking place. Now, before we move on to discuss Impressionism and Post-Impressionism, let us take note of something very briefly, that is the advent of photography. By 1840, around that time, camera was invented and photography gradually and rather very fast developed as a new medium of replicating the reality visually, and it became a very powerful thing. So photography happened to be not just a new way of making images, but it taught us a new way of seeing images, looking at the visual experience around. Let us look at a few photographic examples from mid-19th century onwards. For example, this one by a very, very famous photographer called Felix Nutter, who took this photograph in 1865, as early as that. Then by Wildgrave, horse galloping, 1878. And these are different kind of a technology called teletype prints. And what photography did, as far as painters were concerned, they told the painters that how the camera could actually capture the details of a movement, for example, which our naked eye tends to miss out on. It's difficult to notice each and every detail of a moving object, whereas camera can't do that. So, not that photography was posing a stiff competition for the painters, but because of this wonderful visual developments and technological developments happening in the field of photography, the art, the visual art, the art of painting and sculpture, certainly got a signal. They received a signal that maybe now they have to do something else, because the very realistic kind of painting which the painter used to do before was gradually becoming irrelevant, because photography can do that. A camera can actually replicate and represent the reality perhaps better than any painter. So photography kept on developing very rapidly, and it kept on changing not only our visual experience, but also our expectations from produced images. And with camera, a photographer could reach places, spots, areas which was difficult for a painter to reach. So the access for a photographer seems to be very wide. The range is extremely open. Possibilities are multiple. So, in the wake of this, in the context of this, what would be the new position? What would be the new ideas that painters should now ideally be looking at? So, Impressionism, in a way, is connected to the advent of photography. Because photography changed painting events. When artists like Monet discovered how photography worked, the capturing of individual grains of light, Monet and other artists, they also began to change the concept they had of art and painting. Trying to capture things realistically via painting was pointless, since the camera could do that. So, Impressionist painters rebelled against hard lines of neoclassicism. There are no hard lines in nature. This is what the painters, Impressionist painters, noticed. And thanks to photography, they noticed that lines do not exist in nature. Concern of the painters should be more with light and color. Because light was more or less taken for granted, or light was used as a tool to create a chiaroscuro, light and shade. But the fact that light can actually create the form, the fact that light can be considered as a component for form, was something new in the history of painting, and Impressionists were trying to do that precisely. Because the painters and Impressionist painters felt that objects are not so much things in themselves as they are agents for the absorption of color and light. Probably they took this idea from the latest developments in the optical science. So shadows are not black or gray, but tend to take on a color complementary to that object. They tried to brighten up paintings by using primary colors to increasingly convey the illusion of sunlight through a prism. So, as a result, the color palette, and particularly the ranges of tones and colors in Impressionist paintings became quite prismatic in a sense. And the very notion of color, the very reason for the existence of color in a painting also changed a great deal. And along with that, of course, subject matter, which had been undergoing some changes right from the Romanticism period. The Claude Monet's this particular painting called Impressive Sunrise, painted in 1872, is considered to be the first Impressionist painting ever painted. Though Claude Monet himself didn't realize that he was creating history, but he did realize that his painting, when he first put it on display, not many people could actually accept this painting. This painting received severe criticism, very harsh criticism, and many art critics, in fact, criticized this painting by saying that this painting is a sketchy painting, this painting is an incomplete painting. This painting doesn't have the clarity of lines or forms. This is a careless painting. And the further say that painting is such a grand activity. You can't do a painting simply based on ephemeral, a very momentary inspiration or impression. It has to have a grand content, which this particular painting was apparently missing, according to the art critics. Interestingly, later on, when Claude Monet's painting, this particular and other paintings, and paintings done by other painters who also followed a similar idea of painting, got accepted in the history, their entire movement, or the title, the name of the movement, was derived from the title of this painting, and hence the movement came to be known as Impressionism movement. Look at this painting by Claude Monet. Once again, a similar approach. A similar concern can be observed in this painting as well, where Monet is not at all bothered with the details. and the clarity of the details, but he is more bothered and concerned and more interested to deal with the role that light and state and light and darkness and its tonalities play in constituting epigrams, additional images. And as a result, somebody like Claude Monet would be almost like a study that artists are usually expected to go out and study, maybe an architecture or figures, a landscape or not yet. So similarly, Monet used to go outdoor, and he used to study the same object, in this case, for example, this particular cathedral, the Rouen cathedral, again and again, in order to capture the essence of this particular architecture, not the static essence, but the changing essence. In fact, what he shows in his several studies of this painting, of the same architecture, is how the appearance, the look, the impression of a solid architecture like this one, that Rouen cathedral, keeps on changing as the direction of the light changes, as the quality of the light changes, as the color of the light changes, the object, and in this case, the architecture, also changes. Now, this was certainly something new, a very, very new proposition, because until Impressionism, painters took light, or the relationship between light and object for granted. Light might be changing, the direction of light also changes, but apart from a slight tonal change, the general impression of the object, architecture or figure, has always remained more or less static and same. Now this is going to change once and for all, once the Impressionist movement gears up, and other painters, not only Monet, but Monet, Monet, Pissarro, Sisley, they will all be more or less following, and they will be studying how the quality, the character of the object changes along with the change in the light, because their premise was light is something that is not constant. This is a very important premise based on which the entire movement called Impressionism developed. Light is something that is not constant. Light is something that is constantly changing, shifting, not only in terms of direction, but also in terms of the quality of light. A. B. According to Impressionist artists, not only that, light changes and hence the color and tone of the object on which the light is falling is changing, but even the color of the shadow is changing. So until Impressionist paintings, color of the shadow was thought to be something that is fixed. Okay, brownish, dark, grayish. But in Impressionist paintings, you can see that the cast shadows, shadows on the ground, they also assume different colors depending on the surrounding colors or colors of the surrounding objects. So the fact that light, the visual reality around, is something that is not static, is something that is not fixed, is something that keeps shifting and changing all the time. And then how do you capture this changing and shifting character in a painting which is also fixed within a given frame? Impressionist painters have always tried to solve this paradox by inventing new methods of painting and also innovating new ideas of painting. So it is not only in landscape painting. You can see a similar phenomenon happening also in paintings like this by Renoir, where the subject matter is the celebration, or maybe a party boat of a middle class society. Even here, you can see that the flickering light, that you can see the shifting light is visible very evidently, and perhaps it has got something to do with the life also, which is as shifting as nature. Edgar Degas. Now, he is also looking at the possibilities of capturing a movement that itself is not static, and hence he selects ballet rehearsals. He selects different postures of dancers and ballet dancers as his subject matters. And at the same time, the fact that his paintings often look cropped, almost like a photograph, is also an impact of his exposure to photography. Otherwise, Degas' paintings would have looked very truncated, very incomplete. But in the light of the new visual and aesthetic ideas, Degas' paintings do not look truncated. But from the point of view of a classical painting, Degas' paintings would look incomplete, truncated, and even the composition would have looked disbalanced. So, people like Degas, Monet, not only that they are inventing new methods of dealing with the shifting character of life, but they are also looking for new subject matters and new compositions. Composition becomes immensely important for the Impressionist painters. So, Post-Impressionism is in a sense a continuation of Impressionism. But at the same time, it is also slightly different from Impressionism. How? For example, in Post-Impressionism you find a collection of artists with very diverse individual styles influenced by the Impressionists. But it is here that Post-Impressionism is a continuation of Impressionism. But it seems that Post-Impressionism was also a reaction to the limited Impressionist view that paintings should be all about life. Post-Impressionists wanted to be something more. Post-Impressionists continued using vivid colors, no doubt about that. They continued applying thick layers of paint and pigments with distinctive brushstrokes and real-life subject matters, but they were more inclined to emphasize geometric forms like Paul Cézanne, to distort form, to expressive effect like Van Gogh, and to use unnatural or arbitrary color like Paul Gauguin. So this is how many Post-Impressionist paintings look like. For example, if you look at this painting by Cézanne, Mount Saint Victoire, you can see how the landscape has been painted not simply as a view, but as a pretext to deal with the relationship between line, light, form, space, and also a vision, a very personal individual vision of Cézanne towards this phenomenon called landscape. Paul Gauguin. Look at this painting by Paul Gauguin. Here, he is obviously referring to some kind of mythical subject matter, but the sense of color that he is applying to this painting is absolutely unconventional, non-academic, and in that sense, arbitrary, very, very arbitrary. But obviously, he is having his own logic. He is having his own sense of why and how he is using the colors and in what sense. Then, of course, you have one of the most famous painters of all times, Vincent van Gogh. Now, whatever he paints, it could be his interior room, or a night cafe, or a starry night, or a cornfield, or a simple sunflower, or portraits of his friends or himself, self-portraits. He is looking at the possibilities of using line, color, form, space in a way that expression of the subject matter gets the privilege or the most privilege over anything else. And it is also true that in many of his paintings, Van Gogh is not really bothered with perspective or the correct anatomical features and all that. He is bothered with expression. He is also following his intuitive sense of color, space and form, like the way Romantic painters also did. In Post-Impressionist period, we also have this very interesting artist called Lecture-5. And his subject matters are mostly about people whom he used to observe in opera, in theater houses, in bars and in brothels. Lecture-5 had hardly done in landscape, but the way he painted the people, his subjects, and the way he empathized with them, with very sketchy, drawing-based kind of idiom, is amazing because the very notion of oil painting was different at that point of time. Equally exceptional was George Seurat, another French painter who belonged to the entire movement. If we combine both the movements, Impressionism and Post-Impressionism, there we will find many painters like Degas, Seurat, who were part of both these movements, both these places. Seurat was one of them. Now, Seurat went on to develop a particular technique of painting called pointillism. If you have a close-up look at this painting, you will find that his forms, whether it is a figure, or tree, or dogs, or water, or foliage, anything, they do not have a solid entity. All these forms are made up of small, tiny dots or points. He developed pointillism because this is what he wanted his paintings to perform. Perform the task of breaking down forms into small, little, tiny, light particles. Possibly, Seurat was greatly inspired by the development of optical science at that point of time. But to apply that knowledge to a creative work like a painting was a big challenge. Of course, after Seurat, there were a few painters who followed this method, and that is how this kind of painting got this name called pointillism. But pointillism itself was not an art movement. Pointillism was a technical method, but at least when Seurat was following this technical method, he was able to arrive at a wonderful visual result. Maybe his figures often look very steady, still, almost like they are not able to move. They are fixed in specific positions and points. Yet, his figures, his land, his sky, his light, they all have a tremendous vibrant quality. And this quality connects to the paintings to both Impressionism and Post-Impressionism in a very meaningful way. Now, each painter in this movement pursued unique personal subject matter, and while sharing stylistic goals with the other Post-Impressionist painters, they all had a personal form of expression, which is quite evident when you go through the paintings by Cezanne, Gauguin, Seurat, Lecture-5, Van Gogh and all. For example, Cezanne abandoned the Impressionist virtuoso depiction of evanescent light effects in order to pursue his preoccupation with the underlying structures of natural forms and the problem of unifying surface patterns with spatial depth. Both Goya and Van Gogh rejected the indefinite objectivity of Impressionism in favor of a more personal, spiritual expression. Sura and his followers concerned themselves with pointillism, the systematic use of tiny dots of color. So the diversity that is evident in post-Impressionist period is quite interesting. At the same time, all these painters, and along with their previous masters who belong to Impressionist period or Impressionist movement, they signal absolutely a clear deviation from anything or everything that was traditional. And that was one of the reasons why many of their paintings, like Van Gogh's paintings, Monet's earlier paintings, many of these painters had a tough life when they were at the top of their careers, in the sense that very few people during their time could actually understand what exactly they were doing. By and large, most of these painters were completely misunderstood by their contemporaries. And later, of course, we got accustomed to their paintings. We are able to appreciate their paintings, we are able to enjoy their paintings. But just imagine how these paintings must have appeared to the eyes of art critics and art lovers and art viewers who were familiar with and more habituated with a certain kind of art tradition against which Impressionist and Post-Impressionist paintings obviously looked incomplete, stagey, careless, and also meaningless to many people, because they failed, Impressionist and Post-Impressionist paintings failed to satisfy the norms of the traditional Western art. Yet, these painters, like Van Gogh, Gauguin, César, Lautre, they were undaunted. They went ahead with their ideas because they were convinced with what they were doing. And as a result, today, we should feel grateful to these artists and to these movements, because it is because of them that modern art has reached where it has reached today. They paved the way, they liberated the history of modern art from the shackles of the norms of the traditional art. And that is why today in Van Gogh's paintings we do not have, for example, any problem to appreciate the swirling sky, very agitated platform, extremely imaginative color palette, but definitely it must have looked very odd and unacceptable to the people who were more familiar and more comfortable with the traditional art. This is by no fault. A painting like this, without any grand subject matter, even in terms of composition, it must have looked tilted or disbalanced. But today, we know how to admire these paintings. Or for that matter, a still life by César, where there is a sense that the fruits are about to fall off from the football. Perspective is not steady at all. There is a sense of tilt, sense of topple, but yet there is this very strong, substantial feel about every object and the entire composition, which makes César's paintings so admirable. In fact, Paul César has been considered by many art historians as the true beginner of modern art. why. Apart from various reasons, the fact that somebody like Pablo Picasso, one of the greatest icons of modern Western art, would be inspired by Cezanne's paintings. And very soon, in early 20th century, Picasso would be introducing a very radical art movement called Cubism. In fact, this incident makes Cezanne the true beginner of modern art. So, we have been looking at the several beginnings of modern art. And from the next week, we will be looking at all the major early movements of modern art which took place from early 20th century.